Good day and welcome everybody to our fourth webinar, the second in English language. I'm Stefano Pernetti. I'm part of DEXA sales department and I deal with the sale of spare parts and after sales service. First of all, please switch off the microphone and camera to avoid interferences. And if someone doesn't hear my voice, write in the chat section and we'll try to solve the problem in real time. And if during my relation there is some point for which you need clarification, write your question and I reply at the end of this webinar. We decided to use technology to introduce you to the maintenance activities on our units. As you know, the life of any machine depends on proper maintenance, and a cooling tower, an evaporative condenser, and evaporative cooler are certainly no exception. Today's webinar will focus on this and specifically the ordinary maintenance activities to be carried out on our models called CFR-A and REF-A. The CFR-A model is a closed circuit evaporative condenser made of Z725 galvanized steel with axial fan, suitable for applications in industrial refrigeration. The REF-A model is a closed circuit evaporative condenser made of Z725 galvanized steel with axial fan, designed for cooling water without contaminating it with the atmosphere and suitable for industrial applications, conditioning, and power generation. Both models consist of an upper fan section, an intermediate exchange section, and a lower basin section for the water collection. From this section, the list of activities to be carried out will begin. Ordinary maintenance activities are performed when machine downtime is foreseen, and all of this is secured from the needs of those who manage the plant. If we talk about a plant that goes to serve the conditioning, the unit is operational for about 8 months per year, so the remaining period can be used to carry out all the checks and some extraordinary maintenance. If the unit is part of an industrial plant operating 12 months per year, a few consecutive days of downtime are usually expected to carry out maintenance activities, but it would be good to organize to have a few more hours outside the expected downtime. This is because some periodic activities require more than just one annual intervention. Let's start by checking the basin section. An operation to be carried out following the manual removal of the inlet grids. Following the prior removal on this support, unscrewing the bolts using a 13 wrench or a screwdriver having a socket of this size. Once removed, the condition in which they are placed can be verified, and they also can clean it by using a pressure lens at the same distance so as not to damage them. If this activity is not sufficient, it's necessary to evaluate its replacement. After this, it's possible to inspect the inside of the basin. You can proceed with the removal of the protection filter. It is removed by pulling it upwards to clean it and evaluate if it's necessary to clean the basin itself. Also checking if there is a presence of signs of scale or corrosion. Regarding this eventuality, I allow myself to open a parenthesis. In addition to proper maintenance, the integrity of every unit is also subject to proper water treatment, which must be carried out by a specialized company. Upon delivery of a new unit, the customer received the use and maintenance manual of the same, both by email and in a paper format inside the assembly box. Inside the manual, there is a page, as you can see, containing a table showing the range of water chemical values. Who deals with the water treatment must refer to this table to carry out a correct activity. We remind you that in case of need, the manual is available and we can send it by email at any time. That said, it can check the fall of the water from the nozzle at the bottom of the basin. If the rain from the bottom of the exchange coil flows evenly from the whole surface, it means that there are no clogging or fouling problems. We will return later on this. Once these checks have been completed, the air inlet grids can be repositioned and stopped by fixing their support to the structure, then proceed to checking the electric water circulation pump. It's simply a visual inspection aimed at checking there are no signs of wear in the casing and signs of scale or oxidation inside the terminal box. After removing the cover of the same. Once this is done with the pump running, obviously, it can be verified that the data resulting from the electrical panel to which the pump is connected, I mean voltage, absorption, etc., correspond to those shown on the plate applied to the pump. Now let's move on the control of the exchange section and the fan section. I unified both sections because to carry out the various checks, the entry point is the same. I mean the inspection door located on the fan section. To get there, if there is no ladder and platform installed on the unit, a component that we can supply or request as an option in a new unit or as a spare on a already installed unit, is necessary to use a lifting platform. It's useless to remember that since it's a job at 8, you need to have the necessary PPE. I mean safety belts, helmet, etc. Once the inspection door has been removed, you are in front of the drift eliminators located in this green zone, which must also be removed for two reasons. The first one, to check their integrity and verify that they don't have problem in terms of dirt and clogging. The second one, to be able to verify the situation of the distribution system. I mean pipes, secondary heaters, and their nozzles. To verify that the water sprayed by the nozzle uniformly covers the entire surface of the exchange coil. If not, it's necessary to manually remove the secondary heaters, the pipes with the nozzles are connected, bring them to the ground and clean them with a pressure lens. If it's not enough, they must be replaced. As I explained before, it's necessary that the recirculated water sprayed by the nozzles is properly treated to avoid falling problems on the coil. For example, consider that a 1 millimeter layer of limestone reduces the performance by 10%, 2 millimeter by 20%, and so on. In this case, if you have this problem, you can contact a specialized company to carry out a chemical wash. But in my opinion, prevention is the best way. Heat exchange coil. It consists from coils made of optically galvanized carbon steel. In the ref model, the fluid inside is always water. In the CFR model, the fluid inside is a chemical compound, mainly ammonia. This is the only difference between the two models. I mean ref and CFR. So now let's proceed with the inspection of the fan section. We can have three different situations. The first, direct coupling. I mean, motor and fan are directly coupled. Gearbox transmission. We have the motor connected to the gearbox by means of a coupling joint. In the gearbox, the oil inside is to be replaced once a year. Unscrewing the cap in the lower part, the oil to be replaced comes out. Removing the cap in the upper part, it's possible to insert the new oil. If you need this, contact us and we'll give you information on the type of oil to be used and the right quality. The third situation could be belt pulley transmission. We have the motor and its pulley connected to the fan and its pulley through the transmission belt. So, in this case, we can proceed to check the belts. Obviously, the motor must be turned off and the area must be set up to carry out all activities safely. Belt tension checks. Let's go. As you can see, the wheelbase T is the distance between the center of the two pulleys. This distance must be reported perpendicularly on the belt and then calculate its middle point. At this point, we connect with a tensiometer, this simple device, to push the belt away from the near one by 1.6 centimeter if the wheelbase T is 1 meter long, 3.2 centimeters if it's 2 meters long, etc., and so on. At the end of this operation, the tensiometer must give a value between minimum and maximum. Otherwise, the belt tension must be changed. I indicate that the values of type A and type B belts because they are the most stainless models. Warning. These values shown refer to a single belt. For example, we have three single belts for a three group pulley. Currently, the belts we install are single baked with as many inserts as there are pulley grooves. This solution is more effective because a single baked belt does not fall even if it's loose. Therefore, the tension values must be multiplied by the number of the insert in the belt. For example, I mean, if we have a three groove pulley, the values multiplied by three. With a four groove pulley, these values multiplied by four, and so on. The belt model followed by a number indicating its length is stained underneath. These data are very important because if you want to buy new belts from us, we need them to provide you with the correct one. In any case, when you need some spare parts, the best way is to send us an email with enclosed a photo of the nameplate applied on the unit. It's important to remember that incorrect tension shortens the life of the belt, bearing, and consequently of the whole transmission, especially if the belt is over-tensioned. To change the tension of the belt, it's necessary to act on the tie rod located on the motor support. In case of belt pulley transmission, as you can see, the shaft that connects the fan to its pulley is fixed to the support with two bearings, which must be greased every 4 months or 3,000 hours of operation. Above each support, there is a lubricator line to which the pump nozzle must be connected. This pump for a greasy bearing must contain a lithium grease characterized for bearings. The quantity of grease to be used corresponds to about three pumpkins. Just to understand, I mean the quantity of a soup spoon. Remember, too little of grease will cause the bearing drying. If the grease is too much, it will come outside of the bearing seal and will collect the dirt on the outside by introducing into the bearing and will damage it. Okay, now we can proceed at the control of the vibration by using the vibrometer. This is what we use. It's equipped with an extendable cable at the top of which there is a magnet, with much first be fixed in the low point of the support on which the motor is installed. Once this is done, exit the unit, turn on the vibrometer, which will take a few seconds to set itself, and then start the motor, leaving it running for about a minute, and detect the data that the device provides. Once this is done, stop the motor and repeat the operation after fixing the magnet at the high point of the motor support. This is the procedure for directly coupled motors and fans. In the other two cases, the same thing is done by fixing the magnet to the gear support or to the shaft support, and then externally to the motor support. The maximum tolerated vibration value is 4.5 millimeters per second. If the measured value is higher, if necessary to understand the reason, it may be due to a damaged motor, a damaged fan, a damaged support, etc. In this case, in my opinion, the best way is to do a relation and take some picture, and then send us them in order we can help you to solve the problem. After this last check, we can reposition the drift eliminators, close the inspection doors, and start the motor to return to operating. That's all. So now I check if there is some questions. Hello everyone, you too. Is the gearbox made in Italy as well? Is it available in our your warehouse? So the gearbox is made in USA. I consider that if it's not available in our warehouse, it needs about 8 weeks for provide it. How to calculate evaporative condenser performance? So if you want to know this data, it's necessary to send us an information. I mean which model you have, because the performance change due to the type the model you have. What's the advantage of direct drive fan motor? So I reply to you, explain the advantage of the other solution, gearbox or belt pulley transmission. We use this situation when the customer has a problem at level of noise. When the noise level of directly coupled is too high, we suggest to consider the other two solutions. The advantage of directly coupling at level of maintenance can be that is too easy to remove the fan for maintenance. So waiting some other questions. I remind you to follow us on our channels. So on our website, among other things, you will find references on maintenance activities and spare parts. On our YouTube channel, you will find many tutorial videos about replacing components on our units and recordings of our webinars, including this one soon. On our LinkedIn page, you can find out our news and the dates of the next webinars. If you need some information of about the service of after sales on spare parts, you can find my email pernetti@dexa.eu and my mobile phone number. I'm at your disposal 24 hours per year. Per day, sorry, night and day, better during day. So when I will close shortly the session, you will see a short questionnaire about your satisfaction. Please fill it because it will help us to improve. So I see there are no other questions. If you have, if you need further information, I remember you to contact us by email. What is the lifetime for coil condenser of cooling tower CFR? So I remember that the life of a unit is under a proper maintenance and a proper water treatment. Under this, we can guarantee a minimum of 20 years of life. So there is a question, assembly section, but I can understand. Sorry. Jagadish, if you want, send us an email about this information. So, okay. I just have to thank you for your attention, greet you, and remind you of stay tuned because, as we say, evolution is cool. Bye bye, ciao.